If there is a human being who was closest to Jesus, it was Mother Mary. She gave birth to Jesus. All the life, she was with him, and she even saw him die. She was there right from the point of birth as the Son of Man, from the time of birth till his death, and even after the death. So you understand, she was with him. She was so close. The book of Isaiah chapter 43 verse 7 says, "And we all are created for God's glory." Mary knew that her choice was according to God's plan. So today I want to tell you, you and I, whatever we do, the benchmark question is it for the glory of God? Is my action, is my speech, is my thought, is my word, whatever it is it giving glory to God or is it taking away the glory of God? Mary did everything for the glory of God. So God has a plan for each one of us also, just like he had a plan for Mary. And as the word says in the book of Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11, that his plan is for our prosperity and not for our destruction. It's a plan to give us a future and a hope. So today I want to tell you, if God has revealed any plan for you in your life, I think you should just jump at it without looking at the consequences. I'm speaking myself also. That if there is anything that God has shown, don't look at the consequences, jump at it. Because that is a fulfillment of your creation here. God's plans gets fulfilled. Hallelujah. Again, you know, Mary knew her role in God's salvation work and never imposed herself on Jesus at all. You know, you'll find one thing that, you know, Mary knew that she had a purpose and a role in the life of Jesus. And she never intruded onto his public ministry. Only one place probably that she intruded was at Cana, as the word says in the book of John chapter 2. But Jesus asked her one thing. "Oh woman, what has that got to do with me?" He says, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not come." Actually, there, Mary was probably pressurized into making a recommendation. I'm not going into the theoretical or the spiritual side of it, but I want to tell you, Mary never intruded into the life of Jesus because she knew that she had a role to play. And that role was to become the biological mother of Jesus. Today you and I have our own roles to play. We have to play our role faithfully and not impose ourselves on Jesus. So whatever the role given to us, whatever is God's plan, we must surrender our lives to him so that he can work his plan in our lives. Because you understand one thing, that Mary was a person who really understood her position. She knew that she was just like any other person. She had a special privilege of becoming the biological mother of Jesus. But in every other respect, she was just like any one of us. She, as the word says, never ever had in her mind any concept of becoming a co-redemptrix. Are you with me, my dear brother and sister? Because there was such a great movement. At one time, there was a priest going around taking signatures from believers so that a representation can be made. I don't know, maybe it's in Rome or somewhere, that Mary should be declared as a co-redemptrix. And what a sad state of affairs, because Mary herself never dreamt of her being a co-redemptrix. On the contrary, she confessed that she needed a redeemer. Are you with me? She confessed openly in the word. The word says in the book of Luke chapter 1 verse 46. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord." Here was a person who was worshipping and magnifying Jesus. Are you with me? Today many people are magnifying Mary over Jesus. My dear brother, my sister, I'm not telling this to disturb you. I'm just trying to tell you the word of God. Mary was a person just like any one of us. She had a role to play to become the biological mother of Jesus. She did that or played that role to the hilt, you could say, 100% perfection. And then she stood out. She did not impose herself on the work of Jesus, on the salvation work of Jesus, no. But on the contrary, like I said, she confessed that she needed, or rather, that she confessed that she needed to worship God. She confessed that she needed Jesus as her redeemer. So in all respects, she's just like you and I. In every respect, she's there. Because the word of God says even Jesus was like us in every respect except that he did not sin. The word of God says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So all includes everybody, except the word of God says, but Jesus did not sin. Therefore, Mary is just like anybody else. If you have sinned, she has sinned. If you need a savior, she needs a savior. If you need to worship Jesus, she also needed to worship Jesus. She worshiped Jesus. She also confessed that she needs a savior. The next verse says, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my savior. What does a savior do? A savior saves. A person who saves is called a savior. Saved from what? The word of God says in the book of Matthew chapter 1 verse 21 that you shall call his name Jesus and he will save his people from their sins. So Mary also needed to be saved from her sins. This is just the word of God. I want to tell you again and again. It is with great prayer that I am speaking to you that you will not get disturbed but you will be open to the Spirit to understand the truth, because God's word says in the book of John chapter 8 that you shall know the truth and the truth will set you free. We all love Mary. We love Mary. We love Mary. Say we love Mary. We love Mary. Hallelujah. So you'll find Mary also confessed her need for a Savior. Because you understand one thing. One of the greatest things, the instruction that she has given in the word of God, there are not too many places where she has spoken. But the greatest, I would say, the greatest word that she spoke is in the book of John chapter 2 verse 5. He says, his mother said to the servants, whatever he says, you do it. Whatever he says, you do it. Are you with me? See, this is not just related to turning the water into wine. It is a comprehensive statement about whatever he says, do it. Whatever God's word says, do it. That is his command, her command. That is her preaching. That is her instruction to everybody who loves her. Are you with me? Because God's word says if you love God, you will obey his commandments. If you love Mary, you will obey what she said. Are you with me? You will do whatever he says. And what he said is there in the word of God. Because John's gospel says very clearly that the Holy Spirit will bring to your remembrance all the words that I have spoken to you. It is not just the changing of the water into wine. Whatever the Lord has said is here. Because again, don't think that what Jesus said is in the four gospels. If you read the word of God in the book of Romans chapter 1 to 3, you will find that the whole scripture is concerning his son, Jesus Christ. Are you with me? So from the book of Genesis unto the book of Revelations is all about Jesus and what he spoke. So what he spoke, do it. That is the command. Because you find if the God's word says in the book of Mark chapter 12 verses 21 to 31, it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one. You shall love the Lord thy God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. Then do it. Are you with me? Do it. That's what the Lord says. Obey his word. Oh, again, if it says that the book of Exodus chapter 20 verses 4 and 5, I think we should read it. There are certain items where we need to, there are so many things that the Lord has said, but I just want to bring to your attention just a few things which people are blatantly violating. The book of Exodus chapter 20 verses 4 and 5 says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and the fourth generations of those who hate me. So this is what the Lord says. Mary says, do it. Obey it. Again, if you read Psalm 78:58, it says, for they provoked him to anger with their high places and moved him to jealousy with their carved images. So don't do it. Don't build for yourselves high places and don't put carved images there. Again, Psalm 97:7 says, let all be put to shame who serve carved images, who boast of idols, worship him, all you gods. He says again, you'll be put to shame, so don't do it. Mary is telling you, don't do it. Obey the word. Again, if you read Hosea 8:4, it says, from their silver and gold they made idols for themselves, that they may be cut off. See, when you disobey God's word, he says, I will cut you off. Which means there is a severance with the relationship with God. Are you with me? Just like what happened to Adam and Eve when they sinned, they were cut off from the glory of God and their nakedness was revealed. They'll get cut off. And Deuteronomy, this I must read. Hallelujah. The book of Deuteronomy chapter 4 verses 15 to 19. Oh, it is so explicit about what you should not do. My dear brother, my sister, I want to tell you, man might make a lot of misrepresentations and misinterpretations of God's word. That God's word, the book of Corinthians says, the simplicity and the purity of Christ. His word is simple. His word is pure. His word is clear. So let us go in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 4 verses 15 to 19. It says, take careful heed to yourselves, for you saw no form when the Lord spoke to you at Horeb out of the midst of the fire. This I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister. God's word says very clearly in the book of John chapter 4 that God is spirit. No man has seen the form of God. The images that you see, the images that you carve out, my dear brother, my sister, that is not the face cut of Jesus. No, it is not the face cut of Jesus. Because God's word says very clearly, take careful heed to yourselves, for you saw no form when the Lord spoke to you at Horeb out of the midst of the fire. Lest you act corruptly and make for yourselves a carved image in the form of any figure, the likeness of male or female. So we are not supposed to make any statue, my dear brother, my sister, and to keep it in a place of worship, a male or a female. Then it says, the likeness of any animal that is on the earth, or the likeness of any winged bird that flies in the air, the likeness of anything that creeps on the ground, or the likeness of any fish that is in the water beneath the earth. And take heed, lest you lift your eyes to heaven, and when you see the sun, the moon, and the stars, all the host of heaven, you feel driven to worship them and serve them, which the Lord your God has given to all the peoples under the whole heaven as a heritage. Hallelujah. So you'll find here, the Lord is cautioning us. Some people's lives are driven by the position of the moon, the sun, and the stars. The Lord says, they have been given to you as your heritage, as your inheritance, to serve you. The sun to give you light by day, and the moon to give you light by night. They are to serve you. But many people, their whole life is centered around, controlled by the sun, moon, and the stars. Hallelujah. And it says clearly, you shall not make any image. My dear brother, my sister, God cannot be more clear than this. That you shall not make means you shall not make. There is no compromise in this. So if there is a dilution, then that is not of God. So I want to urge you, when you obey God's word, like Mary said, do it. When he says, don't make, do it by not making it. Are you with me? Again, I want to tell you, this is confirmed again by the Father himself. If you read the book of Matthew, chapter 17, verse 5, we know the mount, the transfiguration of the mount. What did the Father say? He said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. Hear him. Hear means obey him. Hello? Hear him. Hear him. What? The book of Revelation chapter 19 verse 13 says, his name is the word of God. Hear him. Hear the word. Listen to the word. Obey the word. That is what the Father in heaven is saying. And if the word says, you shall not make any carved image. My dear brother, I want to tell you, do not make. Do not bow down. Do not garland. Do not burn any candles. Do not put any arms. Do not do anything. Have nothing to do with statues. Because that is an abomination to God. I want to tell you again, you read the book of Joshua chapter 6. God's people went to conquer the city of Jericho. God said, do not touch anything there because it is an abomination to me. And Achan touched and brought about death on himself, his family, and even the poor donkeys that was with him. So today I want to tell you, you'll be bringing about a curse of God on your life if you disobey God's word. Because he says, I'm a jealous God, cursing unto the third and the fourth generation. So he's jealous for you. Why? Because he's betrothed to you. Hello? He's your husband. He paid a price for you. And you are committing spiritual adultery. The book of Hosea 5:4 says, you have got an adulterous spirit. Then we should read that. Book of Hosea 5:4. They do not direct their deeds toward turning to their God, for the spirit of harlotry is in their midst, and they do not know the Lord. There is a spirit of spiritual adultery. That is why if you read the book of James chapter 4:4, he says, you adulterers and you adulteresses. That is what the word addresses. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? So today I want to tell you, take this seriously, this message seriously. Because if you love Mary, you will obey her. Are you with me? If I love my parents, I will obey my parents. I cannot rebel against my parents and say that I love them. The demonstration of love is being subject to them. When Mary, you say, I love Mary, then you obey what she says. Obey only what she says. She never said you have to pray to me, worship me. No. She never said I am a co-redemptrix. No. On the contrary, like I told you earlier, she said I need a redeemer. And Jesus is my redeemer. I am worshipping my redeemer. I am magnifying my redeemer. We have to do the same things. We have to magnify our redeemer. We have to confess, Lord, I need you as my redeemer. The salvation is only in your name, Lord. There is salvation nowhere else except in the name of Jesus. This is what Mary wants you to do. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So today you must understand, that is what Mary, she was setting an example. And many people, one of the, they say, all the believers, especially they talk about the Pentecostal, they say, they consider Mary as an eggshell or something. Eggshell. After the chicken is hatched, the shell has no value. No, my dear brother, my sister, don't degrade Mary to that step. Nobody says she's an eggshell. She's a person who is a daughter of God, just like you and I are sons and daughters of God. And when we love our Father, we'll obey His word. She obeyed God's word in her life. You and I have to obey God's word in our own lives. For her, it was to become the biological mother of Jesus. Today for us, is to again birth Jesus in the spirit realm. Are you with me? She was there in the physical and spirit realm. She birthed Jesus. Today you and I have a great commission to birth Jesus, to give Jesus to others. Hallelujah. Because again you will find the scripture goes on and on telling about how Mary was just like anybody else. If you read the book of Acts chapter 1 verse 14, it says, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary the mother of Jesus and his brothers. So Mary was all with the disciples. They were together waiting for the coming of the Holy Spirit, the falling of the Holy Spirit, for the power of God to fall upon them. Because Jesus said, tarry, wait till I come. Again, Acts 2:1-4. Again, you'll see that Mary was very much there experiencing. She was part of the 120 people who were experiencing the great power of God, the Spirit of the living God falling upon them and demonstrating the power, the change that they can do. He says, when the day of Pentecost had come, fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. All this was happening to Mary along with the other 119 people. She was just like any other person. Please understand from the word. Because if she was something again above, then there would be no need for her to be there. But the word of God says that she was with them in one accord. She experienced the same presence of God. She needed the same presence of God. She needed the Holy Spirit of the living God. Just like even Jesus needed the Spirit of the living God. So let's understand the word of God in its true perspective. Hallelujah. So you must understand one thing. To conclude, I think we are just overshot a little. To conclude, you must understand that God's best servants are often very ordinary, plain people who have made themselves available to Him. So if you read the book of 1 Corinthians, you will find that it is not the strong of the world they took, or it is not the intelligent of the world, or it is not the people of social reputation that he took. He took the weak, he took the poor, he took the base, so that he could build them up into something that is good. So it's our availability, not our capability, that is relevant at all in the hands of God. Again, you will find another thing is that God's plan involves extraordinary events in the lives of ordinary people. Are you with me? Extraordinary events in the life of ordinary people. Like someone said, there are no miracles in the kingdom of God. There are no miracles in the kingdom of God. Because every day happening, every miracle that the world thinks is an ordinary happening. Are you with me? There are no miracles in the kingdom of God. Because every miracle which the people say is a miracle is an ordinary happening because God says so. Because if you're sick, you get healed. That's ordinary. Because that's your birthright. Are you with me? That's your inheritance. Hallelujah. Again it says, a person's character is revealed by the response to the unexpected. If something unexpected happens in your life, how do you react to that situation will be actual revelation of the character that you're having. That is very clearly said, demonstrated in the book of Romans chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. He talks about tribulations. You have tribulations. That leads to what? Perseverance. And perseverance leads to what? Character. And a character leads to a hope. The quality of that hope is that I have the assurance that that hope will not disappoint me. Why? Because I have again an assurance that my God loves me. And where did I get the assurance? Because the Holy Spirit put it into my heart. Are you with me? So when there is trials and tribulations, my character builds up. How do you react to your trials and tribulations is a demonstration of your character. When things go wrong in your life, do you start blaming God? Do you start questioning God? Do you start asking God why you are not there? Do you start disobeying God's word? Or do you stick to the word? What will be the consequences? Like Mary, we know that because she stuck to the word, she exposed herself to a death penalty. But God is above all laws. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is in control. He will ensure that nothing wrong will happen in your life. When you do something in obedience to God's word, the spirit of glory will rest upon you. That is what the book of Peter says. When you are persecuted for the sake of the kingdom and his gospel, it says the spirit of glory of God will rest upon you. Hallelujah. So you don't have to worry, my dear brother, my sister, if you're going through trials and tribulations for the sake of the kingdom of God. God's word again says that if you lose your father, your mother, your brothers, sisters, your fields, your houses for the sake of the kingdom of God and the gospel of Christ, you will be rewarded with 100 times, including persecutions. So I want to tell you, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Why? Why persecutions? Because that is one of the conditions. If you read the book of Romans chapter 8, it says that you shall also be glorified with him and you shall also suffer with him. I think we should read that. Because there is no crown without a cross. Are you with me? There is no crown without a cross. And if you want to get the crown, you need to bear the cross. It says very clearly, hallelujah. It says, and if children, then heirs. Romans 8:17. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we also may be glorified together. So if you want to be glorified together, you have to suffer with him. As the word says, if you're united together in the likeness of his death, you shall also be united together in the likeness of his resurrection. Death is painful, but resurrection is victory. Hallelujah. 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 That is why the word of God says, are you born again? You have to die to be born again. Hello? Just going and dipping yourself in some aloe vera doesn't make you born again. Hello? Or some people say, it was in an inflatable tub in a flat. Doesn't make you born again. It makes you born again because when you die and when you resurrect in the newness of life, then you are born again. If you are able to say that I have been crucified with Christ, it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of Jesus who loved me and gave himself for me, then you are truly born again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Otherwise, I tell you one thing. In the papers, you will find matrimonial ads. You will say, born again, girl, age so much, born again. That is paper born again. They may be born again, I'm not saying. But born again is in the heart. Are you with me? It is not a matter of it is not a denomination. A lot of people think it's like CSI, Martoma, Catholic, born again. No, born again is not a religion. Hello, real born again is a relationship that I've died to the world, to sin, the flesh, and to Satan. And I've given my life to Jesus. The old man is crucified and the new man is resurrected. That is born again. Hallelujah. How many of you are born again? Hallelujah. Then you have a right to say something. That we must be, when we have the same submissive spirit like Mary. When not looking at the consequences, you are able to give your life totally, unconditionally in obedience to God's word. Then you will be able to say that, hallelujah, you are actually in living in eternal life. You are living eternal life in your life. Because God's word says in the book of John chapter 17 verse 3, eternal life is to know the only true God and Jesus Christ whom he sent. You are living eternal life. I want to tell you again, my dear brother, there is a false notion that eternal life starts after you die. Eternal life doesn't start after you die. If you are not in eternal life here, you will never be in eternal life when you die. Because it's like a plane. You have to board the plane while it's here. If you don't board the plane, you can't jump into it after it takes off. Are you with me? You have to board the plane of eternal life while you are here. You have to get into the ark of the Noah's ark, which is symbolizing Jesus, while before the storm and the waters came, before the door was shut. Are you with me? So you have to get into eternal life while you are here. Make a conscious decision. Make a committed decision for Jesus. That irrespective of the consequences, I am going to say, as Mary said, behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be done to me according to your will. I am willing to obey your word, Lord. Then you again have a confidence, a right to say that surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, because I've started dwelling here. Hello? Because I started dwelling here, I can say I will dwell forever. Hallelujah. Only thing is, you start dwelling from the earthly in the house of the Lord, you will move into a spiritual house which the Lord has prepared for us. To be with him, to worship him, and to fellowship with him. Hallelujah. So today I want to urge you, my dear brother, my sister, I want to tell you once again, we believers love Mary just like you love Mary. We have got nothing against Mary. We never say that she's an eggshell. She's not an eggshell. She's the mother of Jesus. She was a woman who was the most privileged to give birth to the Son of God so that he can become the Son of Man. Are you with me? We love her. We love her. But we don't worship her. We emulate her. We learn from her life. We learn to do the things that she did. We learn to obey her because she loved her. And she said, do whatever he says. Do what the word says. We as believers are trying to do that. Are emulating her. I urge you, my dear brother, my sister, if you really love Mary, obey God's word. That's all that you have to do. And then you will demonstrate your love. It is not the outward demonstration of going for novenas or burning candles or putting saris or putting garlands or putting arms before her statue. That is not a demonstration of your love. God's word says, if you love me, you will obey my word. If you love Mary, you will obey her commands. Mary says, do whatever Jesus says. And what Jesus says is here, my dear brother. The book of life. This is here. Obey her. And then you will be demonstrating your real love for her. Others say outward love. But if you love her in your heart, you will obey God's word. Because she obeys God's word. She needed a savior just like you and I did. You and I do. And she magnified Jesus just like you and I are supposed to magnify Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah.